going to talk about, oh, let me do this again. Good morning.
Good morning.
So today we're going to talk about the most important habit. And I've been walking the bridge in Titusville. I don't know if you've been to that bridge, but you're excited about the bridge in Titusville? That's good. Some of you need more things to do. That's the most exciting thing. But anyway, so I've been walking the bridge in Titusville, and the other night I was wearing my glasses. How many of you wear glasses or contacts or had LASIK or something? Raise your hand, raise your hand, raise your hand. All right, if you never had to have those, would you raise your hand so we can all boo you? No, I'm just kidding. We won't do that to you. So I'm proud of you for having good eyes. But so you won't understand the illustration. So today's sermon is just wasted on you people. But most of us. So while I was walking the other night, my glasses, because I was walking, were starting to bother me. So I took them off and walked. And as I was walking, you know, I came up the bridge where you're looking at the bridge of the lights. And all the lights, this is how bad my eyes have gotten, all the lights look like starbursts. Okay, so I had this blur. It was like one big, you know, stack of light. And then as I came up on top of the bridge, I can see like down in the valley. I can see, you know, blue and red and all kind of lights. I'm trying to figure out, is that a policeman? Cars were passing me. I couldn't even tell what the cars were going past me. Okay, so that the vision has changed. I'm getting older and it's getting worse. And so those of you who wear glasses or contacts, most of us, the very first thing we do when we get up in the morning is we put our vision, whatever it is, to try to clear our vision up. Here's the spiritual implication of this, because as I was walking, I was praying and thinking about this message. In life, it is easy. You can be a Christian for years and yet not have a clear view of life. You can be a Christian for years and lose that spiritual clarity because you get busy doing service, or you become selfish, or you become self-centered, or life just gets in the way. And even if you read God's word, if you're not careful, even while reading God's word, that can become blurry. You can become a Pharisee. And if you're not careful, if you don't spend time in real, authentic prayer. But if you'll learn how to pray, I promise that God will change you. And God will change the clarity, how you view not only yourself, but the people around you. And he will change the people around you. Now, for those of you who have been Christians, I don't have to convince you of this. So this makes the first part of this sermon very easy. And what I want to do today is first of all, give you reasons why we don't pray, give you some keys to prayer, and then go through the Lord's Prayer. Not as just that's what you're supposed to pray as a rote thing where you just, our Father, art in heaven, love you. But to go through it as a pattern for prayer. So first of all, we're going to talk about why we don't pray. Number one, we don't want to put God first. Truth is, we're selfish. Sometimes we have sin in our lives. Sometimes we really don't want to deal with it. So we just say to God, God, I'm kind of happy doing my own thing. So we don't want to pray. Number two, we don't know how to pray. For some of us, we have never been taught how to pray. Number three, we believe in activity, not prayer. We're just busy. We're busy doing stuff. And so we think, I just need to do stuff. And we get so busy doing instead of being. So I want to encourage you, don't just think God wants a relationship with you out of what he wants you to do. It's a relationship. And I'll talk more about that as we go on. And then finally, we are performing. And we're not genuine. And this is a big one. This has to do with us thinking we're earning God's love or comparing ourselves to others. So let's talk about keys to powerful prayer. Now, if you have your Bibles, we're going to be going to Matthew chapter 6 in a few minutes. And you can turn there. Or if you have it on your phone like I do, you can turn there. But we'll have it on the screen. We'll have it in your notes. Most of us, or many people, think that they're praying when what they're really doing is a hostage negotiation. We think we're praying, but what we really think of as prayer is a hostage negotiation. Here, let me show you how it works. So we give God our list of demands. God, here's my list of demands. Have a great day. Now, I don't know about you, but if you had a relationship with somebody, now you may have a boss like that pretty much his relationship with you is, here's what you need to do. Have a great day. But if you really want a relationship with people, it's not just about asking them. So imagine if I want to have a friendship with Bob, our drummer, okay? And I love Bob. Bob's a great friend. And imagine if my relationship with Bob, every time I saw Bob, I said, Bob, here's a list of things I want you to do to be my friend. See you later. And then the next day I came up and said, did you finish that list yet? What kind of relationship? We wouldn't have a relationship, right? It would be a hostage negotiation. Many of us think we're praying when we've never taken time to get still. We've never taken time to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. And truthfully, we've never asked God to change us. We're just going to give him our list of demands. That's a hostage negotiation, not prayer. Don't confuse the two. So here are some keys. We're going to give you three keys. Number one, take time to pray in private. As busy as Jesus was, and of course he prayed on the way and he prayed during, but Jesus took time out to pray. And here's the directions Jesus gave in Matthew chapter 6 as he was teaching the disciples to pray. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. We're going to come back to that word in a minute, okay? We're going to come back to that word hypocrite, so hang on to it. For they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who's unseen. Then your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. So first I want to talk about this idea of hypocrite. By the way, if somebody ever comes to you and they say, I don't go to church because of hypocrites, just look at them and go say, I'm one of those. You can come with me. Because we all say things that we don't live up to. You know, if you want to find out if the pastor's a hypocrite, just ride with me in the car one day when somebody's tailgating me. Now, I'm praying for them that they would blow a tire or, you know, right? Right? Yeah, so right? You're there. Okay. So, you know, they're attacking me. These people in these other tanks are coming after me. But a hypocrite, literally in scripture and in the Greek and in the Greek world, hypocrite literally meant an actor. Because in the early Greek plays, what they would do, different acts of the play, if it was a sad moment or a happy moment, they would put on a different mask in order to pretend about who they were. And Jesus looks at people who are only praying in public and he says, hey, don't be fake. Now, let me tell you one of the dumbest things you can do in life. You're like, really? You can tell us the dumbest thing? Yes, if you know me, you know I'm an expert on dumb things you can do in life. So let me tell you the dumbest thing you can do is pretend before God. Because he knows you. He knows everything about you. He knows what you do right and he knows what you do wrong. He knows how he created you. And guess what? He knows you better than you know you. So when you come to God, it's okay to say to him, God, I'm struggling. God, I'm tired. God, I'm lonely. God, I'm sad. God, I'm so happy. God, I'm worried about this friend. It's okay to let God know, hey, this is who I am. God, you know where I failed today. Be honest. Don't be an actor. But then it says, close the door. Go to a private place. It's the idea of getting alone. Jesus did that. Jesus actually hid from people. He turned off his phone. You know how I know that? Because the disciples came and they said to Jesus, everybody is looking for you. Which meant that all the disciples went to all the places trying to find Jesus. And Jesus was hiding to pray. And here's what's awesome about this verse. It says, your Father who sees what's done in secret, listen, will reward you. How many of you would like a reward from God? Anybody in here would like a reward from God? Okay, look around. If somebody doesn't have their hand up, would you poke them and tell them to wake up? Or ask them if you can have their reward because they don't want it, right? So this is one of the places in the Bible that it says, you want a reward? Pray in private. Find a quiet place. Find a place where nobody is and pray. So here's the question. Do you have a specific private place to pray? Number two, remember that prayer is about God's goodness, not yours. And when you pray, don't keep on babbling like the pagans. By the way, pagans in the pagan temples spoke in tongues. And not only did they speak in tongues and they had no idea what they were saying, they also would just babble like, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, or their God, in Baal's case. And actually, in the Old Testament, the Baal worshippers running around began cutting themselves, and they cried louder. And Elijah's like, hey, maybe he's sleeping. God's not asleep. And you're not earning the right to pray to him. If you're a Christian, when you said, Jesus, I give you my life, he gave you the right to come into God's presence. I posted a verse this morning from Ephesians that basically says, you don't have to walk in fear, you can walk in boldness when you pray. Not because of you, but because of Jesus. This is what sets Christianity apart from every other religion. You don't earn your way to God. It says, don't be like them. Why? Because your Father knows what you need before you ask him. And this is the idea that God absolutely loves you. When you go to pray, understand, God knows what you need. Now, a lot of you gave ransom demands. That was your prayer this morning. You gave him ransom demands. He knows what you need. And sometimes when you don't know how to pray, you know how I pray sometimes? God, I don't know what I should pray for this, but you know, you pray for me. There's actually a verse in Scripture that says that the Spirit prays with groanings. And I think sometimes that means that we go, you know, some people think of that as tongues or something, but I think sometimes it's. Do you believe God loves you as a father and hears your prayers? Number three, not only pray in private, not only remember it's about his goodness, you're not earning your way to prayer. Number three, pray in the Spirit and listen. I'm going to talk about what this means because people get caught on the wrong part of this passage. And pray in the Spirit. That means, that doesn't mean pray in tongues. It means be sensitive to the Holy Spirit in your heart. It means be sensitive. God's doing something in you. Don't just give ransom demands. Listen to God. How do I know that's what it means? Because it says, on all occasions, with all kind of prayers and requests, with this in mind, be alert and always keep praying for all the Lord's people. Why would it say be alert? So that you can listen. Because here's what will happen when you're praying. You're in your prayer time, and I have a, and I'm going to talk about how I pray, but I have a list, and I'm praying for different people. And sometimes when I'm praying for somebody, maybe they're sick or something's going on, or I'm praying for people in the church, and God just puts one of you on my heart. And I feel like, you know, you should call so-and-so. I cannot tell you the number of times that I've called somebody or texted somebody or emailed somebody or Facebook noted somebody or tweeted somebody or I'm trying to think all the other ways I send notes to people. Smoke signaled somebody. Faxed somebody. I'm sending fax at you. Anyway. And they said to me, how did you know that this was going on today? And I said, I didn't know, but God knew. So be alert. And here's the other thing. Can I tell you what God convicts me of most of the time when I'm praying? My selfishness. Most of the time when I'm praying for myself or a situation, most of the time God has to say, you know whose attitude is wrong in this situation, right? Theirs. Well, Eric, you're not responsible for them. You're responsible for you. No, no, God. They're the ones who gave me the apple. Oh, wait. That's in the Bible. Ask God to speak to you with his Spirit and be ready to act. Be ready to act. So let's talk about how to develop a habit of prayer. And we're going to use the Lord's Prayer. But I just want to lay out kind of what my morning looks like. Okay, typically I get up, try to get up before everybody else. That's my goal. I have children. That doesn't always work. So, and what I do, or one of the first things I do in the morning, I have my cell phone all the time. How many of you have your cell phone next to you even when you sleep? Would you raise your hand? Did you know, I forgot what the percentage is. I think it's up to almost a third of people fall asleep with the cell phone in the hand at least once a week. Scary, isn't it? Okay, so let's use your cell phone for good. What God, what Satan can mean for evil, God can use for good. So here it is. So I've got a band called Elevation Worship. That's the kind of the newest thing. I've got several bands on my phone and Bethel and a bunch of them, Hillsong. But right now my favorite is Elevation Worship. So first thing in the morning, I push play on Elevation Worship and start getting my heart set right. And then I do the second most important thing. I get my coffee ready. And I'm addicted. Yes, you can pray for me. Okay, so this is tea, so you know. All right. So then I sit down at the table. I have a book that I use called the 2959, and I've put a journal that's just blank pages in the front. And I open the app on my phone for the Daily Bread. I have that app. And I don't do the reading first. I do the, what are the verses for the day? So usually they have 3 to 5, maybe 10 verses. And in my journal, I write down the verses. And then I write them in my own words. What is this verse saying to me? And then I wait. And I say, God, are you trying to show me anything in this verse? And I let the Lord speak to me. And I just let him show me. What is it in His Word. The Bible says that the Word comes alive. The Spirit brings the Word to life. He uses it to cut us, to change us, to encourage us, to make us different, to convict us. Not only of sin, but of righteousness. So I spend time. And then I have a daily part of my journal that's every day I pray for certain things. And I have that in my journal. And then I pray specific things each day of the week. That's how it's organized. So I spend time doing that every day. Now here's the deal. That's called the 2959. It doesn't matter what you use to pray, but you really ought to have some type of direction. Because when you don't have direction, you typically don't do anything. Or you just, if you're like me and you're ADD, your brain just wanders around and squirrel, right? You just, you're like that dog, squirrel, right? That's me. And so that's my routine. And Jesus was not saying when He prayed the Lord's Prayer, by the way, how many of you have the Lord's Prayer fairly memorized? Maybe you don't know a word or two. But yeah, most of us have heard, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come," right? And I'll never forget going to a church where, you know, I showed up with my girlfriend in high school, and they prayed the Lord's Prayer like this:
"Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven."
I wanted to say to people, do you have any idea what you're even saying?
Yes, I do.
What? Because you never talk to somebody that way, but we talk to God that way, like He's so good to hear others. So I want to break it down for you. And listen, Jesus prayed the Lord's Prayer two different ways. It's here, and then it's in Luke 11. And it's almost like, Lord, did you forget the prayer? Because He wasn't saying pray specifically just like this. He was giving us a pattern for prayer. So here it is. Number one, focus on God as your wonderful Father. Focus on God as your wonderful Father. Jesus says, Matthew 6:9, "This then is how you should pray. Our Father." Time out. This word for Father in the Greek is the word for daddy. It's what Jesus said on the cross. It's the idea of intimacy. The Pharisees and Sadducees would never have considered this a good way to pray to God. Because they're like, God is standoffish, God is this. And Jesus says, no, He's your daddy. He cares about every need you have. So when you start to pray, the first thing to realize is God wants a relationship with you. This is not a hostage negotiation. Our Father. You're a good Father. Now, you may have an awesome dad, and you may have a horrible dad. If you had the best dad in this room, he was 100 times better than anybody else's dad, that's just a touch of how good God is. You just had a taste of God's goodness. God is so much better and knows so much more. And you start out, Our Father in heaven, and then you have to put the balance. Hallowed be your name. That means you are awesome. You are set apart. You are pure. It's the idea that God, even though you want an intimate relationship with me, you are so far above anything I can imagine. You are so awesome. So listen, next time you're outside, and you see all the stars tonight if you're outside, maybe you see some of the planets, maybe you have that app that you can go around like this and go, "Oh, I never knew that." As you're looking at the stars, here's what I want you to know. The God who can create the stars in a moment loves you. So when you start the Lord's Prayer, He's saying, hey, He's your dad in heaven, and He's awesome. And you may have to just start your prayer by saying that. Some of you, if you never got any farther in prayer, this would help you to clarify your life. By understanding that you have a good Father. If you're a believer, that Father wants a relationship with you so much, that's why He sent Jesus to die for you. Not because He needed something to do, but because He wanted a relationship with you. That's the reason Jesus came. So do you view God as your loving Father? Take some time every day. Start your day saying, God, I view you. I know you're my loving Heavenly Father, awesome and great. Number two, put God's agenda before your agenda. Here's the second part of the prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So here it is. Your kingdom, that's your rule, your reign, your desires be done. And then your will, that's His purpose. This is one of the second hardest parts in the prayer. Because this is you saying to God, I surrender to you. And a lot of us, if we're honest, we don't want to surrender to God's will. We want my will be done. If we're really honest, we want my will to be done. And when you get to this part of the prayer, here is the part of your prayer time that you have to say, God, is there any part in here where I have my own agenda? God, would you show me the selfishness in my heart? By the way, nobody sees selfishness in themselves unless God reveals it. We think we have it together and those other people are messed up. And so God, show me the selfishness. Show me any hurts or habits or hang-ups, those sins in my life where I refuse, just like that baby, I refuse to surrender to you. I know she's been in the hospital, so we want to pray for him today. Are you willing to accept God's will over your will? So not only do we focus on God as Father and surrender to his agenda, number three, we ask God to provide, forgive, and help you forgive. And this is the part that I think none of you have ever thought about, because I had a pastor last night who was a pastor for years say, I have never heard that. Here's what's really cool. He says, give us, by the way, he doesn't say give me. Have you ever noticed that? Most of the time when we pray for daily bread, we just pray for us. I had a lady come up this morning who told me I was an atheist for years before I gave my life to Christ. She comes every week now. This is the first church she's ever been involved with for any length of time. Her parents prayed for her for years. She said, Eric, I know my parents were praying for me when I thought my life was great, but I was running from God. And here I am today. She's actually one of our greeters now. By the way, one of the things that happens when you realize how much God loves you, you begin to serve. And one of the things that happens when you quit serving is you've forgotten how much God loves you. So here's the deal. Listen, so you have to say, God, give us. So Lord, provide for others. But here's what's wild. When it says our daily bread, bread is not just the sustenance you get. This is the word for the showbread in the temple. The temple bread was also called the bread of presence. It represented Jesus. It was actually combined with frankincense. You've probably heard of frankincense before. There was some story about that, a couple in the Bible, right? And so here's the deal. Not only are you praying for physical provision, God, you provide. I don't provide for myself. You provide for me. So not only that, and by the way, that helps you to learn to give, because as you realize God's the one providing, you don't mind giving because he's in charge anyway. So when he tells you to give, you give. One of the signs of a neglectful heart is when we don't learn to give. Because when we understand this, God, you give to me. Everything I have is yours. But it's not only physical provision. It's not only money. It's not only food. This also represents the presence of Jesus. So the next time you're praying and you get to this part, give us today our daily bread. It's the reminder, God, I know you're with, would you remind me that you're with me today? God, as I go through this difficulty in my life, would you remind me that you're with me? God, when I go through this challenge and I'm needing this job, or God, I look back and I see that you were with me in the past when I forgot. God, would you remind me that you are with me in everything I do? And then here's the hardest part of the Lord's Prayer. You ready for it? Buckle up, buttercup. And forgive us our debts like we feel like forgiving. Like I feel like I want to, when they deserve it. I'd like to change this verse to something else, kids, but I can't. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Let me tell you what forgiveness is and what it isn't. And this is where a lot of confusion happens in churches especially. Forgive does not mean forget. There's nowhere in the Bible that it says forgive and forget. If you want to talk about forgive and forget, you have a psychological issue. The only thing I can forget is where I put my keys. Okay? But forgiveness is about releasing a debt, so that when Joseph's brothers came to him and he talked to them, he said, what you meant for evil. So he didn't say to them, I think what you did to me, you know, putting me in the cave, hoping I was dying, you know, putting me down in the well, selling me into slavery, I'm here all these years, I think that was awesome. He didn't say that. He said, what you wanted to do for evil. Basically, he said, you guys did evil, but God used it for good. What did Joseph do? He released their debt. So here's the deal. You don't have to trust somebody that hurts you. You don't have to let them back in your life. Yes, you have to give them boundaries. If they're doing something that's damaging, you have to give them boundaries, but you can forgive them. Which means this for many of you. Some of you had people hurt you years ago. You had somebody who doesn't even, they may not even be alive anymore, but they hurt you. And when I talk about forgiveness, you think, Eric, I can't forgive that person. Listen, you're not bothering them, but it's holding you captive. And I would love to tell you that forgiveness is easy. I'd love to be able to say, yeah, you just pray it and it just happens and it's great. He's not even forgive. And unless you're on lithium, it's not that easy. All right? So here's what I want you to know. Listen, You may have to choose to forgive and forgive again. Some of you, it may be somebody who's alive and you cannot even talk to that person, and that's okay. You may need to write a letter that talks about, I just want you to know I forgive you for A, B, C, D, E. And by the way, that's not their responsibility. It's not between you and them. It's really between you and God. And you take that and maybe you burn it or tear it up. Maybe it's somebody who passed a long time ago. And here's the deal. You may wake up tomorrow and you may feel angry again. Your teeth might green. You may have that person cross your mind, or you're out doing something and suddenly that person comes to mind again and you find yourself going, ah, they owe me. That's when you say, I choose to forgive them again. I choose to, and you may have to do it with your hands. I choose to forgive them again. I release their debt. They don't owe me a thing. Why? Because God forgave me. And you may need to pray, God, I don't want to forgive them, but I'm going to choose to because I know you forgave me. Listen, we're all broken. We're all broken. We all need grace. God gives us grace every day, and he pours out enough, and you and I can learn to pour grace out on others. And truthfully, between you and me, your life will be better when you forgive. Psychologists say that most mental illness is related to unforgiveness. So you need to look and say, God, is there anybody I haven't forgiven? And let him work on you. So here's the two questions. Do you feel you provide for yourself? And let me say it another way. Do you realize that God is the one that provides for you? I can look at your checkbook and tell you if you think that or not. Because when we think we provide for ourselves, we become very stingy. We think that we're in charge of our money. We're in charge of our things. But when we realize God provides, we begin to look to others and say, God, this is all yours. How do you want me to use it? And we become better stewards. We don't just blow money here and there. We begin to look and say, God, this is your money. How do you want me to do with it? Because we understand, God, you're providing. And then the second part is there anyone I haven't forgiven? You ready for this? Including yourself. Some of you, when I talk about forgiving others, you're like, no problem, got it. But you look in the mirror and you go, you know, I did this thing. I blew it here. I messed up here. And just like the woman caught in adultery, you and I need to hear, does anybody else condemn you? And Jesus looked at her and said, I don't condemn you either. And we have to throw down our own rocks that we're throwing even at ourselves and say, God, you've forgiven me, and I choose to forgive me. God, you've forgiven me, I choose to forgive them. That's the hardest part of prayer. Number four, ask God to change your habits and give you strength and lead us not into temptation. That basically means don't let us give in. Some of you need this verse on your refrigerator. But deliver us from the evil one. That means what the enemy tries to do, he will attack you with selfishness and selfish thoughts and tell you you deserve whatever bad thing you're going to do. This, listen, let me give you a simple illustration that you all understand that relates to all sin. If you go on a diet today and you decide, I'm not eating cookies, cookies will be delivered to your house this afternoon by someone. A Girl Scout will knock on your door, somebody will throw some Thin Mints in the freezer, right? And you can't eat one Thin Mint, you gotta have a little sleeve, right? Some of you are like, I'm headed home, I'm gonna buy some, right? So, I've ruined some of you. Every temptation is the same way. As soon as you begin to say, I don't wanna do that, that's when it draws you to it. That's what the law does. That's the reason we say, God, would you deliver me from giving in? Because there's always gonna be temptation. The enemy will tempt you with everything. Whether it's lust or pride, arrogance, comparing yourself with others, any type of selfishness, any time that you begin to think God doesn't care about you, that's the enemy. He's tempting you. He tempted Jesus and said, God doesn't care about you. Throw yourself off of this hill. I'll take care of you. The enemy always wants to say, take care of yourself. God doesn't care for you. And so you have to say, Lord, would you help me to realize any sin in my life? And by the way, all of us can see sins that people do that affect other people. All of us know an alcoholic or a drug addict, and we can see that they're not only ruining their lives, they're messing up other people's lives. And we can see it, but they can't see it in themselves. Most of your sins you can't see in you. So at this part, you say, God, would you reveal anything? And you confess it. God, I'm sorry for this area. God, help me in this area. Lord Jesus, help me with my driving. I just want to run people over. And Lord, help, right? Lord, help me when I do. And listen, here's the awesome part about God. He knows you better than you know you. Haven't you ever left a situation and you thought, why did I react that way? Why did I say that? And God goes, I know. And so trust him. He knows better than any counselor you can get. He knows you better than you know you. When you go, I don't know why I did that, he knows. And so let him, when you get to this part of the prayer, change you. Let him give you strength. Let him give you strength. Are you asking God to change you and to make you more like him? And then finally today, not only do we focus on God as the Father, not only do we say, God, I want to surrender to you in the prayer, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Remember, that's not only provision, but understanding he provides his presence. Forgive us our debts as we've forgiven those who've sinned against us. That's the hardest one. And then it says, we talk about changing our habits, don't lead us into temptation. And then finally, ask God to help you to walk in the grace you've been forgiven. Watch how he brings forgiveness. Do you know why forgiveness is mentioned twice right in this passage? Because it is the hardest thing in life. Do you know how I know that? Because of Mr. Rogers. How many of you remember Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood? You know what I'm talking about? So years ago, I read Mr. Rogers' autobiography, which is awesome. And no, he wasn't a veteran or, you know, that fought in wars with tattoos. And anyway, but, you know what he said the hardest thing in life to do is? Forgive. If Mr. Rogers struggled with forgiveness, you and I are going to struggle with forgiveness. And so Jesus comes right back around and he says, for if you forgive other people, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you don't forgive others, your Father won't forgive you your sins. Why does he say that? Because forgiveness is huge. Forgiveness, unforgiveness will destroy your life. And here's the deal. When you pray the Lord's Prayer, our Father in heaven, you begin to realize how awesome he is, how small you are, how much grace he's given you. And so you have to start to realize, you know what? Everyone needs grace. If you hang around me at all, it won't take you long to go, wow, that is so disappointing. People come to my group the first week, they come to my small group, and they go, you know that Eric? You should just hear the words of wisdom. And after about the third week, they go, who let him pastor our church? I don't. Why? Because you get to know anybody and they're going to disappoint you. And guess what happens when they disappoint you? They need grace. And you need grace. And I need grace. And they need grace. And so you have to say, God, would you help me to forgive? Especially when it's forgiveness against somebody doing something to you. He says to forgive. If Jesus could be on the cross and say, Father, forgive them, you and I have no excuse. The same Holy Spirit that lives in Jesus lives in you. And I'm not saying it's going to be easy. But you have to say, God, would you give me strength to forgive? And when that unforgiveness comes back, would you help me to choose forgiveness again? We all need it. Everyone. We're all human. The Bible says we've all fallen short. Every one of us. The best person in this room is not good enough for God, but God's good enough for them. And so he gave Jesus to forgive us. And if you're here today, listen, do you view others with the grace that God gives you? I want you this week to take this prayer and maybe take this sheet, go out to the water, find a quiet place, find a room, close the door, whatever, and go through these parts of prayer and say, God, would you help me to focus on these parts of prayer? Maybe you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. If you're going to have effective prayers, you first have to surrender your life to him. That gives you the power and gives you the spirit. If you're here today and you've never surrendered your life to Christ, you know he died for you and rose again, and today you're ready to surrender, I will be here after the service. And you can say, Eric, I want to become a Christian today. Maybe you're here as a Christian and you've forgotten one of these things. Maybe the forgiveness thing is tough. I want to encourage you. Make a new commitment. Say, God, I choose to be obedient and surrender my will to you. A habit of prayer will change you. It'll change how you view you. It'll change how you view others. But it'll also change the people in your life. Don't quit praying. If you're struggling with somebody in your life, pray. Pray for them. Pray for your attitude towards them. It may not be their fault. Shh, don't tell yourself that. But God wants to remove that selfishness, so let him. We're going to have our offering in just a minute. This is a way of practicing some of this prayer. God, I know you provide for me, so I give a percentage back to you like you asked me to do. And as you give today, just give thankfully and gratefully, never because somebody makes you, because you're thankful for what God's done for you. We're going to have our time of giving now, and then I'll be here after the service. If you need prayer, you can come and ask for prayer, and I'd be glad to pray with you. Let's pray today. You ready? Father, I thank you for the pattern you gave us and that you are powerful, awesome, holy God, absolutely loves each one in here and wants a relationship with us. Father, you called yourself Daddy. You want us to know you so intimately, and yet you're so holy and awesome. But Father, you've chosen through your Spirit and through Jesus Christ to give us your holiness, and we are thankful for that. Lord, we thank you for the holiness that comes instantly and the sanctification that comes day after day as we choose to do your will and you sanctify our hearts and our minds. We choose to follow you. And Lord, I pray that you would make Surfside a house of prayer, that this church would be so full of prayer that we'd be able to obey your command to love one another and live it out each day. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Have our time of offering today. We have a great song to close our service. You let God let that message sink in today. Thanks for being here.